the word of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the origin of God's creation. I know your works. You're neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I've prospered, I need nothing. You don't realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Therefore, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire so that you may be rich, and white robes to clothe you and keep the shame of your nakedness from being seen, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. I reprove and discipline those whom I love. Be earnest, therefore, and repent. Listen, I'm standing at the door knocking. If you hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to you and eat with you, and you with me. To the one who conquers, I'll give a place with me on my throne, just as I myself have conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Half-hearted. Aimless. Come see, come saw. Well, maybe. If you were responded to by that, or had that kind of response to something you'd asked someone, something you thought was important, and you got that kind of response, how would you feel? What if I were to say to you that those have been responses I've received over the years from people who profess to be followers of Jesus? Huh. William Barclay, the great Scottish theologian, calls this the sin of indifference. He believed it was the worst possible perspective, the worst possible relationship you could have is to be neutral in your attitude about your faith in Christ. To be neutral. And I've actually heard this expression from parents of children who say, we just didn't want to push religion on our children. We wanted to figure it out for themselves. Bless their hearts. I got drugged when I was a kid. I don't know about y'all. I got drugged to Sunday school, into worship, into Wednesday night prayer meeting. I'm dating myself, but some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Graham and Kason have been drugged too. Isn't that right, Bubba? This stuff had its roots in the early church. Less than 70 years after the resurrection, churches, communities of faith, Paul's work, the apostles' ministry established communities. And in Asia Minor, there were seven churches. And all of these churches were given a letter written because of this revelation that had taken place. John, the writer, the author of the revelation of John, is not the writer and author of the fourth gospel, the gospel of John. This, we believe, was an older man. He was Jewish. He'd learned to write Greek, but English teachers, he was not very good. And yet, it was he who said that he'd received this vision from God and Jesus while he was exiled on the Isle of Patmos, because during the 70 to 90 AD was some of the most vicious times of persecution of believers in Jesus. It was the age of Caesar worship. And the Caesars were gods, self-proclaimed gods. And you could live and take it easy if you first would acknowledge Caesar is Lord. That was present during Jesus' ministry as well. It began during, just preceding Jesus' public ministry. You may remember the day that those Pharisees, they were trying to show Jesus up, and he said, they said, "You, who should we pay? Should we pay taxes to Caesar or should we pay taxes to God?" And Jesus was pretty smart. He said, "Give me a coin." Y'all remember that story, don't you? Render under Caesar. Whose picture's on the coin? Render under Caesar. That's what's going on. It's the culture. It's the landscape. But this church in Laodicea was different from the other six. Every church got a letter and a critique about the affirmations of their work and their ministry and the criticisms. Laodicea only got one. They got criticized. They had suffered from a terrible disease of indifference. And he describes them as lukewarm. Do y'all know what grows in lukewarm environments? Germs. Germs. At our house, you can wash it cold water, you can wash it hot water, you can wash it warm water. But lukewarm? You ever drank any lukewarm coffee? Jesus also made the same kind of distinction with his disciples when he described them as they had lost, like salt. They had lost their flavor. They'd lost their purpose. Salt was a preservative. It was very important, as you well know, in the ancient world. So in this text, once he's called, he calls them lukewarm. He says with intention that the word of the amen, and in that phrase, it means the amen, and it's personalized. It's a name. It's a name for the second person in the Trinity who was the very force of God that spoke in the beginning and there became creation. It is that same person, that same spirit, the second person in the Trinity that became flesh and dwelt among us full of grace and truth in Jesus of Nazareth. And he says to them in response to this lukewarm attitude that they are having and living, "I will vomit you out of my mouth." I don't know about y'all, but if I've been around when something like that happens, I kind of get queasy. I have a father-in-law that you better get him out of the room quickly. I'm told. I've never witnessed it. "I will vomit you out of my mouth." That is graphic, y'all. Why are they lukewarm in Laodicea, you might ask? Because, like the Hebrews in the book of Hebrews, these first century Christians started off on fire for God. They were willing to risk their lives. They were willing to put themselves out there in the midst of Caesar worship. But the economy took an upswing. And their community began to experience economic prosperity. They harvested wool. There was a particular kind of black sheep in that area. And they became a center of manufacturing and sheep, and they became a banking center. They had a medical community that was great. They produced this incredible salve that you could put on your eyes if you had issues, and it would heal. And the sad part about it is that they didn't realize that under all their economic prosperity, their hearts had become hardened. They could not see that they had sold their souls for the almighty dollar. And the Spirit was chastising them, because that's what God has done throughout Scripture. He chastened those he loved. He disciplines those he cares about. And so John said, the Spirit might as well vomit you out because you have lost your first love. You've lost your way. They no longer cared about the least and the lost. They no longer were willing to risk and sacrifice. In a word, they were complacent. They were like what my friends Bob Dominguez, who used to sell Snap-on tools in a truck around Memphis, he said, I got friends that would rather look good than be good. My. I say that to myself sometimes when I'm standing in front of the mirror. It's a terrible thing. But the text, the beauty of the text is after saying and naming and chastising and giving them all the bad news, in verse 19, grace begins to be coming from the words of John. Love calls for discipline and truth. And the truth of the matter is that they did need correction. They did need new direction. They needed to know that God still believed in them. And so once the words of correction came, then comes grace. And he leaves them with this image and this invitation from this most beautiful painting. Some of you remember this from your past experience. It's a painting from that represents Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone would open up and invite me in, I would come in with them and I would sup with them. I would have fellowship with them. Do you know the significance of eating in the New Testament? Jesus was criticized by the Pharisees because his disciples ate with sinners. Jesus ate with sinners. They forgot to wash their hands ritually because they ate with other people. And you know what this word to the church is? Jesus is saying to them, I want to come sit and be with you. I accept you. I receive you. No longer will I spit you out of my mouth. I want fellowship with you. Oh, my soul. Talk about grace. Talk about grace. This is not just a message to the church at Laodicea. This is a message to the church. Because if we were honest today, there is lukewarmness in the house, in the pew, in our alarms, in our lives. There are places where we're just maybe, if I don't have anything else to do. It's easy to drift when indifference comes into our lives. I told you, I like comfort. Last Sunday, I told you, we've got 3 recliners in our living room. But lukewarm is not a terminal disease. Jesus never gives up. We may feel the weight of poor choices and consequences in our lives that we have no control over. We may insulate ourselves with material possessions like buying a sports car when you're 60. I have one. Or other kinds of indulgences. Whatever the case, it does not stop Jesus from knocking. Friends, he wants to be intimate in your life. He wants for you and me every day to stop this crazy charade and rat race of going and doing and getting and is God, who so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever would open up the heart of their lives. That Jesus would come in and he would accept us and want to have fellowship with us. That's what God wants for you and I to do. And folks, if we do that with faithfulness and with discipline and regularity, we won't be able to spell complacency. It reminds me of a song that I sang as a little boy. I'm going to invite you to sing it with me after I sing it once, because I don't want anybody not to know the tune. And if you're not a singer, it's okay. You can just sing in your mind, all right? Because I know not everybody's a singer, and I don't want anybody to be embarrassed because they're going to sing it a cappella. But I'm counting all those folks up there to help. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his. Everybody, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light. God's love and grace disturbs the complacency of our lives. If we would just wrap our minds around just how much he cares for us and let that grow from the inside of our hearts out into our daily living, we would find a joy. Somebody in this room today may hear God speaking to them, and I'm going to be appropriate, that there may be a Gideon to be in this room. There are some people that can serve. There's an auxiliary for wives and spouses as well. You see, when we live loved, we won't ever be satisfied with what is. Because in our understanding of Christian theology, we are going on to be more perfected, more matured, more like Christ because of God's grace. We call it sanctifying grace. Every one of us always can lean further towards God's love and lean into that and let God pour God's Spirit out in our lives so that we and our generosity to others. It may not be to go to the prison here in Lee County and hand out Bibles, but I tell you, there's a shopping cart down at our food pantry on Eason and Industrial with somebody's name on it. And it happens every Thursday morning. And you can stand at the door like Gene does and smile at people when they come in the door. Do you know how much dignity it takes to walk into a place where they're handing out food? I've watched grown men. It takes a lot. That's hard when you got to ask for help. There's a place when they walk in, people are nice to them, and they're kind to them, and they're treated with. And when they sit down at that computer screen, I've watched our servant leaders and volunteers. And then I see the guys and the girls outside when people bring their cars around and there's a buggy full of food and somebody shows up and I can tell you, I promise you, I can tell you that it would be real quick for me to judge somebody when their car is newer than mine. You know what I'm talking about? When their car is newer than mine. But our guys, they say good morning. And they smile. And they open the doors and they say, bless you, have a good day. When Jesus comes into your life like what I'm talking about this morning, and he has fellowship with you, your life's different. And see, you don't just, you know, we eat three meals a day, or some of us do. He wants that every day. He wants you to answer the door to your heart and life, because he can fill your life with good things. Live loved every day. And you'll never be satisfied with what is. You will seek. You will seek after God. Let us pray. Lord, deliver us from lukewarm. Give us a searching spirit and a desire to live loved, to be a channel of grace, to be a person of reconciliation in our community where racism still runs rampant, and classism, all sorts of stuff that would separate us, politics, Lord have mercy. Do we need you today more than ever, yes, to speak to the chaos and to the hunger in people's souls to know and to experience your saving grace. Thank you for Pat, and bless he and his fellow Gideons in their work. And thank you for the chance simply to make a gift today, to provide access through the scripture to your wonderful, matchless grace. Fill us, O God, as we go forth, and pour us out this week as your witnesses. In the name of the Father, and Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to join.